नतिम्रांदस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्। वन्देहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुत पदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगन रघुनाथांबितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगन ललिता श्रीविशाखाम्बितांश नम ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधु दीन बंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमस्ते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानु सुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये। वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यस्य कृपासिन्धुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा। सो वेलकम टू द श्री हरिनाम चिंतामणि सीरीज ऑन इन अटेम्प्टिव चैंटिंग। Yesterday, we were discussing about how we can become free from jada. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur dedicates an entire section from verses 22 to 31 on this very topic. Jada is because of laziness. And that's why we don't have attraction. And we try to finish our rounds quickly and lose the nectar. That's because of the mode of passion. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur is recommending to follow the association of saintly devotees and try to remember the glories of the holy name. And in that association, slowly this jada will be taken out. Follow the conduct of the saintly devotees who don't even waste even a moment. And then the heart will also become like theirs. We will remember the holy name and will become fortunate. Then with the utsah, you remove out jada, alas, because the opposite of alas is utsah. And then increase your rounds and thereby get rid of this jada by determined chanting. So yesterday we began with the details of the utsah technique. And utsah or enthusiasm is love. So we made this exercise. If you are with your beloved, what is your feeling? and what is your feeling when you pick up your beads. And with this, we began this Utsa technique for chanting. And any technique, if it is bona fide, which is anukul, then we'll have to accept. It should be shastric and it should have experiential proof. So we quoted two references from Rup Goswami's third verse, Utsa Nishayat, and Chaitanya Bhagavat, Prabhu Kailan, Ehi Ma Mantra. So from these two shlokas, we are now establishing the Utsa technique. So here is where our discussion yesterday ended. So yesterday we were mentioning this Utsa technique is divided into four sections. The first is a preliminary, which can be performed at home, but the other three require a secluded environment. The preliminary section lasts for 6 months. Actually, the preliminary section lasts for 6 months to 3 years. It requires at least 6 months to 3 years. And the technique for this will be given in full in another book. Another book here refers to actually the 15th chapter also. The 12th chapter of Sri Harinam Chintamani and the 15th chapter are extremely important. Now, why these other three sections need to be done in a sacred atmosphere? It's because we cannot be mixing with the karmis and the other environment where their thoughts or their material vibrations are pervasive, because that is not a conducive atmosphere. So this is where we ended our discussion yesterday. Now let us further now go into the Utsa technique, especially the first section. Today we will be discussing the first section. In fact, the other three sections are not so much in detail. It is the first section only which is in more detail. And if you do the first section of the Utsa technique, practice it over a period of time, say a few years, then automatically the second and the third and the fourth will follow. So let us go into the discussion now further. For this reason, a sanctuary is needed, and that is why Srila Prabhupada hoped to set up peaceful sacred environments in his temples and farming communities. So if you see the entire theme of why Srila Prabhupada wanted to have farm communities, one answer, one statement, anyone would like to make that statement, why Srila Prabhupada wanted to have farm communities? Anyone would like to answer? Raise their hand and answer. Why Srila Prabhupada wanted to have farm communities? Anyone? Yes, Vikram. Yes.
Hare Krishna, Dandu Dhram.
Yes.
Am I audible, Prabhupada?
Yes, yes, yes.
So that the person can, will not hanker for the worldly material things, and the purpose of life is to attain God and love of God. So he will focus on that.
Yeah, the statement, I'm looking for the exact statement why Prabhupada said we should have farm communities. Anyone knows? Can raise their hands? There's another one. Mohan Roop Shyam Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhuji.
To establish simple living, I think, in Prabhu.
Yes, that is there. But Prabhupada had something deeper to say, why he wanted farm communities. Anyone else? Prabhupada said, to save time to chant Hare Krishna. So the farm atmosphere or the countryside atmosphere is the best atmosphere where you save time to chant Hare Krishna. And only if you chant Hare Krishna, you can perfect your life. And the farm community is the ideal setup or the countryside. So that is why that was the real purpose why Srila Prabhupada wanted to have farm communities. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has given the instructions that we should go to a holy place and perfect our bhajan under the guidance of an advanced devotee. Now, this is what not we are suggesting now. Don't think that. Srila Prabhupada's life, yesterday I was speaking, he retired from his family duties, took shelter of Vrindavan Dham, and he was absorbed in chanting day and night and doing his writing. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur spent almost 9.5 years in a small cottage on the bank of Ganga, where his Gaudiya Mutt was established, the headquarters, and extremely fixed in chanting 3 lakh names. Not only that, when Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur moved with Bhaktivinoda Thakur to Jagannath Puri, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has his bhajan kutir in Jagannath Puri. Anyone knows where is the bhajan kutir of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur in Jagannath Puri when he was staying with Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, his father? Anyone knows, anyone has visited that place? Raise your hands. Anyone knows? So these are the places we should try to find when we go to yatras, in fact. In the yatras, especially Jagannath Puri, Mayapur, and Vrindavan, we should try to find out places where saints have sat and done their bhajan. That is the most spiritual potent place. So, in fact, it is not so easy to find out saints in the holy place because they are deep inside, sitting in their confidential secret bhajans and executing their bhajan. To find a saint even in a holy place is not so easy. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, if you have visited the ISKCON temple, which is right opposite to the Haridas Thakur Samadhi, just little backside of that is the Giridhari Mutt. And actually that was the place where Jagadananda Pandit used to reside. And in that place, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to perform his bhajan. So these are the places where we should go, sit, absorb ourselves in chanting the holy names whenever we go to yatras, especially. For this reason, students who are convinced that spiritual life is for them and who sincerely wish to go back home, back to Godhead, should look out for such environment. It is for such environment, not so such environment. For such an environment. So at least we as sadhakas, whether we are in the Brahmacharya ashram or the Grahas ashram or we are in the retired life, we might not have that kind of time, that kind of facility to be in such environments. But especially in a year when we get few days of our holidays, where we go to yatras, where we get to hear from very elevated sannyasis, Krishna Katha, we should also take some time, few days, to spend in these holy places, completely reflecting on Shastra, like about the holy name, and spending time in chanting, especially in the places of Bhajan Kutir, where our previous acharyas have spent time. In fact, among all the places in Radhakund, Radhakund is glorious. It is the most holiest of the holiest places in the entire universe. That's what Upadeshamrit says. But even on the banks of Radhakund, one should spend more time where Raghunath Das Goswami performed his bhajan, where Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami composed his Chaitanya Charitamrit, where the Goswamis used to come together and discuss Krishna Katha. These are the secret places where we should go and spend time. in trying to chant the holy name is, because there is where we can access the mercy of the acharyas. So we should look for such environments, and we should plan out at least in a year, maybe once or twice, I completely spend time in dedicated chanting in such environments. The idea is that first, we must chant 16 attentive rounds out loud. Now we are coming to the Utsa technique, the first section, minimum. So 16 attentive rounds out loud. So why we should chant loud? Srila Prabhupada has said, we had this discussion. Because initially the mind is so much absorbed in material consciousness, to hear the mantra is difficult because there are so many millions of voices there in the heart, of so many impressions. So initially it is recommended that we chant loudly so that we can catch, the mind can catch the sound vibration of the holy name. One should also understand that this is an art and it does not happen by chance. 16 attentive rounds will increase faith and cause anarthas to slowly be removed. So here, remember, it is not 16 rounds. It is 16 attentive rounds. Now, 16 attentive rounds is not an easy task. It is not at all an easy task. 16 attentive rounds, I mean. So we will come to that. With increased faith and purification, the sadhaka then develops an urge to go deeper. In this way, he inquires how to chant without offenses. Any questions, if you have, you can always raise your hand in between. As we have established, teaching and guidance is needed for this. So the first level or section of the Utsa technique gives the sadhaka teachings in a schooling environment, and alongside this, the technique practically shows how to chant the Maha Mantra with attention. So we have also, if you remember in the previous classes, discussed how we can be attentive while chanting. The first was the pranayama technique, which we discussed, where we inhale and with the exhalation chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And why we should do this? To balance the airs in the body so that the airs in the body are not disturbed. Secondly, Prabhupada says by pranayama technique, one can fix the mind. So by regularly inhaling and exhaling while chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, we can fix the mind in hearing the Maha Mantra. This was the first thing we had discussed. The second was Bruvor Madhye. How if you try to focus on your tip of the nose, your vision is inward. So that the senses are not distracted by the sense objects. Similarly, we can close our eyes and focus on the frontal portion of the eyebrows. And this has to do with the present. So if you are in the present, the mind is attentive and we can hear the mantra. The third thing what we spoke was to sit in a right posture and hear the mantra. And if you remember, we discussed the whole mandala, the opening and the closing of the gates. So all these techniques have been included in the Utsa technique so that we can chant attentively. So especially devotees can revisit these discussions what we had, as at least these four discussions, if you remember, we'll have to revisit them and try to apply them so that we can chant the Maha Mantra with attention. By building blocks of attentive rounds, beginning with just 16 mantras and then progressing to one attentive round, and then four, a devotee soon learns the necessity of remaining alert during his meditations on the sound vibration of the holy name. Now, very carefully hear what this point is mentioning. Now, beginning with just 16 mantras. Now, His Grace Burijan Prabhu in his Japa book speaks about this. And this is again another technique, you can say, how we should attentively hear mantra. The Hare Krishna Mahamantra has 32 syllables and 16 words. So the 16 mantras here means it is not 16 Hare Krishna Mahamantras, it is 16 Hare Krishna and Rama, which is there. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this is 16 mantras. So we should attentively fix our mind in the task. The mind should be given a task, one mantra. Just listen to one mantra. That is the task. The simplest task you give to the mind is just hear one mantra. One mantra means the 16 mantras here. If you say the task, oh, today I have to sit in the early morning and chant 16 rounds, then the mind will come with so many excuses. 16 rounds. 16 rounds means 108 into 16 mantras. That is a huge figure. Oh, it's going to be difficult. Then the mind will start rebelling. So just give a very simple task to the mind. Just hear one mantra, that is the 16 names, 16 words. And in that 16 words of the Hare Krishna Mantra, try to be attentive to hear the first Hare. Try to catch the Hare. The mind has to catch Hare. And Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna is there, right? So if you are attentive in hearing Hare, then you will be able to hear the entire mantra. So this is how we begin, by attentively hearing one mantra of 16 words of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. And as we do this one mantra, then we progress to one attentive round. Now, don't be surprised if you start applying this technique and you chant one attentive round, you might be exhausted and you might go to rest also, because it takes a lot of spiritual energy and courage, the mind, to be attentive, especially to the spiritual sound vibration. Is difficult when the contamination is very deep, because the material anarthas or the material chitta finds it very difficult to, you know, fix to the spiritual sound vibration. So initially you might get exhausted even if you chant one attentive round. So don't worry. If you're getting exhausted, it is a good sign. It is a good sign. Just like you have a, Prabhupada gives that simple example, you have a very dirty room which has not been cleaned for many years. And you go inside the room and start cleaning the room, digging all the dirt from below, seeing all the dirt coming up, you might become disturbed and you might feel, oh, so much of dirt and so much of effort you need to put to remove the dirt that you might get physically tired. So similarly, at the subtle level, at the mental level, when you try to chant that attentive round, you will feel exhaustion. So don't worry about it. So if you do that one attentive round, then try to do four. Try to do four and see that you are alert during this meditation. Now here I would like to just take a detour. It's not a detour, but I would like to mention what is Abhyas. What is Abhyas? From the Bhagavad Gita, I will be taking this point. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the 12th chapter, Krishna speaks the last verses, in fact. Mai eva mana adhastva, mai buddhim niveshaye, nivashyasi mam eva, ata urdvam na samshasi. It is 12.8 in the Bhagavad Gita. One second, let me open up the folio. Yes, I'll just share the screen. Yes, this is the worst. Mai eva mana adhastva, mai buddhim niveshaye, niveshasi maya eva, ata urdvam na samshaya. Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Engage all your intelligence in me. Thus, you will live in me always without a doubt. So here, Krishna is speaking about the perfected stage where the mind and intelligence is completely pure. The mind is fixed in Krishna. The intelligence is pure. So the intelligence is under the dictation of the soul and not under the dictation of the mind. Here Prabhupada says that the person, the devotee does not live on the material plane, he lives in Krishna. Nivasasi ma mai eva, he is residing in me. And the holy name of the Lord and the Lord are non-different, therefore when a devotee chants Hare Krishna, Krishna and his internally potency are dancing on the tongue of the devotee. So Krishna is dancing on the tongue of the devotee because his whole body is spiritualized, and Krishna from the heart comes down to the tongue and dances, and he's relishing real spiritual rasa. So this is of a perfected stage, and only one who has attained this stage, ata urdvam na samshaya, Krishna says, he will attain me. There is no doubt about it. But if you cannot do this, Krishna says, if you are not at this stage where the subtle body is not completely pure, he says, ata chittam samadhatum na shaknosi mai stiram abhyasa yogena tata mamichaptam dananjaya. If, oh my dear Arjuna, winner of wealth, if you cannot fix your mind on me without deviation, then follow the regulative principles of Bhakti Yoga. In this way, develop a desire to attain me. So here we are sadhakas who are practicing sadhana bhakti, regulative principles of Bhakti Yoga. Our mind cannot be fixed on Krishna because the mind is not pure. So here is a very important point, abhyasa. Abhyas is what? That is why I came to these two verses from the Bhagavad Gita. Abhyas is what? That we should be alert. We should be alert moment the mind wanders and you become conscious. Oh, the mind has wandered now. What is abhyas? To bring the mind back to the holy name. To bring the mind back to the holy name. And hear and chant attentively the round. Once four attentive rounds have been mastered, the sadhaka learns to put blocks of four and four rounds together and achieves eight attentive rounds. Now, why four? I discussed in other classes that four rounds in Sanskrit is called as granti. Granti means a knot. So by chanting four attentive rounds, one granti is cut in the heart. One knot, hridaya granti, is cut. So that is why we also recommend that devotees, whenever they sit to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, If they cannot sit in one go 16 rounds, then try to break it into maybe 8 rounds and 8 rounds, or 12 rounds and 4 rounds, or 4, 4, 4 and 4, like that. It is always recommended that in the early mornings, you can maximum try to finish 75% of your rounds, that is 12 rounds. And now we are speaking about attentive rounds. 4 attentive rounds you need to master first. Just work on 4 attentive rounds. After you have mastered the 4 attentive rounds, then put on another block of 4 attentive rounds, which will make it 8 attentive rounds. In this way, the technique serves as a torchlight guiding the sadhaka away from the dictations of the unruly mind. So if we do this, then the mind, because the mind is under the dictation of the false ego, and slowly, slowly, when we follow this utsa technique, then the mind starts cooperating and it doesn't become unruly. It doesn't show its, you know, demonic nature, you can say. During this first stage, we are speaking about the first stage of the utsa technique, that is the first section, the sadhaka chants aloud, but also learns the art of internal chanting and of internal visualization, which is a very important part of his future meditations. So as you apply this utsa technique, slowly, slowly, your chanting will become internal. And internally, when you start chanting, you can also visualize. The internal visualization happens on the mind screen. And this internal visualization, initially, we should fix it to not trying to bring the image of Krishna, but just trying to hear the sound vibration. Again, I'm repeating, try to hear the sound vibration and not to bring up visual images forcibly, because Rupa will come only when Naam. First is Nama, Rupa, Guna and Leela. So fix always on hearing Naam. This is what Srila Prabhupada has always recommended. So many devotees many times ask this question, you know, can we think about Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's, pictures, but better to focus on hearing the sound vibration. That art to master hearing the holy name is important, and it takes many, many years. Many years to just be fixed in hearing the sound vibration. And once you hear Naam, Rupa will automatically manifest with the purification of the heart, because Krishna is there in the heart already residing, but now it is covered by anarthas, which is like the cloud covering the sun. Okay. At the end of this stage, now we are speaking about the end of the first stage of the utsa technique. So here we have mentioned it is 3 years. So it will take at least 3 years for us to follow this utsa technique of attentive chanting of one round, in that attentively hearing one mantra, and then building it to 4 blocks, 4 attentive rounds, then building it to 8 attentive rounds. So like that, it will take 16 attentive rounds will take at least 3 years. The sadhaka has increased his daily number of rounds to 25 rounds or more. We can take it as 24. Speeded up his chanting and learned how to be attentive to the Maha Mantra. So if we do this practice over a period of time, it becomes natural that anarthas are being destroyed, and we are able to now increase our speed. Initially, many devotees, I have been having discussion. Initially, when we are chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, the mind is in the mode of passion, and we try to quickly go through the rounds. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur also mentioned that we in turn don't get the nectar of the holy name. If you remember, I think the next verse only he had mentioned here, that at the time of remembering the holy name, one will try to finish quickly. Because of this fault, the nectar of the holy name will not be manifested. So if you try to finish quickly because the mind is in the mode of passion, and we all know that we try to finish our rounds quickly, and we think we are chanting at a very high speed and we are trying to finish our rounds, but we are not getting nectar. This is in the beginning stages of our chanting. But actually, when we do attentive chanting and anarthas are destroyed, when we attain the stage of ruchi, our chanting speeds up. And there we are actually relishing the nectar of the holy name. So speeding up will come up. That's why Prabhupada said quality first, then automatically quantity will come. And don't too much focus on time, how much time it is taking. Especially many devotees I see, they put a timer or a stopwatch to see how much time it takes for one to chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. But again, our attention will go to that and not to the holy name. We'll get again cheated by the mind. So just try to attentively hear the mantra and don't too much bother about the time of speeding up the rounds. It will happen when we do this utsa technique of one attentive round, four attentive rounds, and then building these blocks. Then the speed will automatically increase with ruchi. Ruchi is a stage where the speed will increase. Connection with the holy name in this profound and attentive way in turn allows him to move swiftly through his anarthas and gives the taste that is needed to go further into his ever deepening bhajan. So I already made this point that the anarthas will be destroyed and one will get taste. The sadhaka has now learned how to chant the Maha Mantra internally and how to see addictive imagery within his mind. The word addictive imagery comes from the Greek word adios, which means internal form. The Sanskrit word we use is roop. Now, adios in the Greek means internal form. And now we are coming to nam to roop. Roop. So here, if we are aware that, let us maybe think about an exercise to understand what this statement is. There are unlimited images in the chitta, in the heart. And these impressions are because of the senses which contact the sense objects, which are in the form of impressions in the heart. And such unlimited impressions are there in the heart. Now, if we had to do this exercise where we sit in a proper posture, like in a Padmasana or in a Sukhasana, and if we try to close our eyes and deeply inhale, and then exhale with closed eyes, then inhale, exhale, inhale, then exhale. And then if I had to give you a command, whomever you love the most, your beloved, whether it is your husband, your friend, whoever it is, when we take their name or a famous personality whom you adore, like Mahatma Gandhi or Subhash Chandra Bose, based on what your inclination is, or a famous hero in this world, moment you take the name of such a person, immediately in the mind screen, you can see that the image is there. Because That is where your inclination has been, your attraction has been to that personality, so-called hero or heroine, whatever it is, or a famous personality whom you really adore. So that picture in the mind image comes. Immediately it comes because it is a material image and the mind has been absorbed in material impressions. But if I tell you to do the same exercise and try to now bring the image of the beautiful deities of Radha and Krishna, you will find it difficult to do this. Because Radha and Krishna images are completely spiritual. And because the chit is still contaminated, there are unlimited impressions, it is not so easy to bring up this image in the mind screen. But that is why we have been recommending to just attentively hear the Hare Krishna Mahamantra and not try to visualize in the beginning stages. But if we attentively hear, then slowly the chitta, chaito darpan marjanam will happen and all the anarthas will be destroyed in the heart. And then slowly, slowly from nama will come rupa. Moment you take the name of Krishna, immediately your beloved deity, Radha Gopinath or Radha Shyam Sundar or Radha Madhav, immediately that image can come in the mind screen. So this is moving from nama to rupa. So in this stage, the sadhaka learns how to focus on nam, and by his schooling and meditations, he learns about guna or Sri Krishna's unlimited qualities. So from nama, you go to rupa and then guna. The sadhaka begins his training on how to see form or pictures within his mind's eye. So we spoke about this whole how to see in the mind's eye. The mind is also like a screen, internal screen within us, where we can see images. Just like when you are sleeping, externally your eyes are closed. You are not in contact with the sense objects. But in the dreams, we can see images. And that is being played on the mind screen, in fact. And it is the soul who is observer. So the soul is the seer, S-E-E-R. And what is seen is on the mind screen, the images. And even with the eyes, we see some object. That is what is seen. But the person who is seeing is the soul, that is the seer, S-E-E-R, seer and seen. So internally in the mind's eye also, we can see these pictures. And this is a very, very advanced stage. So this we can think of only after a few years of following the Utsar technique, where we chant attentive rounds. Now, let us come to an example to see where this, you know, is it a fact and reality? Sanjay saw the entire Bhagavad Gita being spoken on the battlefield of Kurukshetra while he was in the palace of Dhritarashtra. How was this possible? We all know about this. Srila Prabhupada says by spiritual television. Or in other words, there is a receptacle device within the mind where one can view events or form as on a television, even though they may happen in a different space-time continuum. So just like any cricket match is going on in Australia, and through the satellite, the transmission is happening, and this satellite is connected to the TV, and here sitting in your TV, whatever is happening in Australia, the cricket match, you can sit and visualize live. Yes? The same technology is there in spiritual technology, spiritual television. Prabhupada used this word spiritual television. It is coming from Prabhupada's lecture. Prabhupada gave a modern technical term for it because we cannot understand spiritual terms. So similarly, spiritual television works like this. As you know, Dhritarashtra, Sanjay was able to see. Because Sanjay's heart was pure, he was blessed by Vyas. Whatever was happening on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, he could see that. Similarly, when the chitta, the soul is spiritual, and the soul belongs to the spiritual world, and the soul can get connected to the spiritual world and realize the events happening in the spiritual world by spiritual television. One big question as to the science behind this point, and in answer, we may indicate that form or rupa becomes manifest because each form is a living ball of energy. So it is energy, it is spiritual energy. That means it is a specific vibratory depth, and this depth of vibration manifests the rupa. So now again, this looks like a very deep science, but let me give you a simple example. Today we have, what is this, microwave. Microwave cooking is becoming very famous now. Now what is microwave? They are agitated, the vibrations are agitated to a certain degree and they start heating up things, right? That's how, you know, the microwave technology works. I don't know in detail. But similarly, if you are tuned to a specific depth of vibration, those vibrations will reveal something. Now, I'm a mechanical engineer and we had a subject called as mechanical vibrations. Mechanical vibrations. And there is a famous story of a bridge where the soldiers were marching at a particular frequency. They were marching at a particular frequency, left, right, left, right, left, right. And all the soldiers' foots were hitting the ground at a particular frequency. There is a frequency. And the bridge was also designed at a particular frequency. The whole bridge structure had one particular frequency. Now the marching of the soldiers on the bridge matched with the frequency of the bridge, and the bridge completely collapsed. The bridge was destroyed. If the frequencies match, then what happens? It can lead to destruction. So similarly, when the Hare Krishna Mahamantra is vibrated, this vibration will reveal the form. Here in this example of the bridge, I was mentioning about destruction, but there it is, you know, in the positive aspect, it is going to reveal the form. For a devotee to understand and see his own swarupa, eternal form, or to understand and see the swarupa of his eternal associates in the spiritual world, or to understand and see the Lord's Shyamasundara form, which is the first form of the Lord that manifests before the devotee, he makes use of Shabda Brahman. That is the sound vibration. So to see our own form, or to see the form of the eternal associates or Lord's form, we have to stick to the sound vibration. Now, as I was mentioning this technique of internal vision, if you remember, image, the internal form, and I was giving you this exercise of how to inhale and exhale three times. Now, while inhaling and exhaling, we have to focus our mind's attention on the breathing, and any sound which is very dear to us, our beloved's name, when we take, immediately the image comes up. Now, my question to you, hear attentively, who is seeing that image in the mind screen? Who is seeing that image in the mind screen? Raise your hands, who would like to answer. Who is actually seeing that image in the mind screen? Okay, there is one hand which is raised. What about others? Who is seeing the image in the mind screen? Okay, now there are 3-4 hands raised, but I'll give first chance to the first one. Dr. Archana Mataji. Yes, Mataji.
Hare Bol Prabhuji. In this case, your soul is visualizing everything. I mean, your soul is witnessing the event.
Okay, the soul is seeing on the mind screen. That is correct.
Yes.
Correct. The soul is seeing. Now, my question is, you can lower your hands now. My question is, but can you see the soul? Can you see the soul? How can you see the soul? The soul is seeing the on the mind screen, the image. But how do we see the soul now? If you can see the soul, then you can know your Swarupa. Yes. Yes, Dr. Acharya Mataji.
Sir, we can witness that particular picture in our through our inner eyes. It means we can imagine something is there which is visualizing the things. So that particular thing through inner eyes.
No.
Seeing the soul.
No, the soul also has its own eyes. Now the soul is seeing what is being visualized on the mind screen. It is the soul who is seeing on the mind screen. This is correct answer.
Yes.
Now, if I have to see the soul, means knowing your Swarupa means to see the soul, that I am the soul. How can we see that? That is my question. This is a little difficult. How can we see the soul? How can we see the soul? Anyone? This is a little difficult. Soul and Paramatma, yes. The soul is seeing, yes. Now my second question is, now how do we see the soul? This answer is there in the Bhagavad Gita. And I'm giving you some hint. 6th chapter, it is there. How do you see the soul now? Anyone would like to try this? Maya Narasimha Prabhu, yes.
Prabhuji, it is...
No, your audio is not functioning. I've unmuted you once again.
Prabhuji, Hare Krishna Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
I'm able to hear you.
Prabhuji, this is that verse, I guess, Prabhuji. Jitatmana prashantasya paramatma samahita sito.
No, not this verse. Not this verse. How can we, now again, just see the image here. This is the soul. This is the internal mind screen. And whatever image we see on the mind screen is seen by the soul. The soul is seeing this mind screen. Now, if I have to see the soul, how can I see the soul? Because seeing the soul means realizing your Swarupa. Anyone? Yes. Okay. Yes, Mataji.
Through your mind screen.
Yes, that is the answer to the mind screen. This is the answer. And let me give you the reference. It is in 6.22.23. Yatra paramate chittam niruddham yoga sevaya yatra chaivatmanatmanam pashyan atmani tushyati. Now let us see what Prabhupada translates this. He says, yatra uparamate chittam. That means the chitta has become purified. Niruddha Yoga Sevaya, by performance of yoga. This chapter is Ashtang Yoga. For us, it is Bhakti Yoga. Okay. Now, yatra cha eva atmana. Now, by the mind you mentioned, but here Prabhupada, see how precise he is in his word-to-word meaning. Pure mind. Pure mind. Atmana. So, only when the mind becomes pure, Pashyan, realizing his position, what? Atmani, in the self, Tushyati. He realizes that he is spirit soul. So the mind, when it is pure, then the mind also acts like an eye by which you can see the soul. That is internal meditation. Yes, somebody mentioned. But the mind, through the mind, we can see the soul, pure mind. So as long as the mind is not pure, then we cannot realize the soul. And that is why one of the symptoms of a self-realized soul is in the 2nd chapter, Chitta Pragya section, it is given. that prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan atman nevatmana tushta sita pragyasa tadauchate, that he has given up all desires. Prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan, which are born out of the mind. Atmani atmana, so here, so again, atmani in the pure state of the soul, eva atmana, by the purified mind. Tushta, satisfied, Sita Pragya, he is a self-realized soul. So the mind is completely pure. There is no material desires in the heart, in the chitta, except the desire to serve Krishna. That is pure desire. So that is how we can see our own Swarupa. So that was the whole discussion we had to know about this Swarupa. So we can know our Swarupa when the heart is completely pure. Now this happens at the stage of asakti, ruchi. After ruchi, where we have taste for chanting and we are doing attentive rounds, we go to the stage of asakti. Slowly, slowly, our Swarupa gets revealed. At the stage of bhava, it is revealed by the Paramatma, by the Lord's you know, spiritual potency, the Ladini Shakti, it gets revealed. But even at the stage of Nishta, one is a self-realized soul. One is able to realize, I'm not this body, I'm a spirit soul. I am different from this body and I don't get affected by whatever is happening to the body. So at the stage of Nishta, one is a self-realized soul, but the internal development of the Swarupa of the soul, a general sense that I am spirit soul is there. But what is the Rupa of the soul, the Swarupa of the soul? What am I actually? Whether I am a Sakha in Krishna's pastimes, whether I am a in Vatsalya Ras, or whether I am in Madhurya Ras, that development happens through the internal meditation in our bhajan from the stages of Nishta, Asakti, Ruchi. These progress. And this is what even Nectar of Devotion, Prabhupada mentions about these five dashas, which we discussed in our first class, if you remember. Shravana dasha, Apana dasha, Smaran dasha, and Varana dasha, and Sampati dasha. I know, I hope devotees remember this discussion which we had. Yes, Smaran dasha, Varana dasha, Shravan dasha, Varan dasha, Smaran dasha, Apan dasha, and Sampati dasha. So hearing, many years of hearing, then you become attached to hearing. Then your remembrance and cultivation, if internal cultivation begins here, and your remembrance progresses, and then your Swarupa is revealed. This is at the stage of bhava. And then you attain perfection. Sampati means you have attained perfection. This is prema. So from the stages of Nishta to Ruchi to Asakti, these three stages go on. The first three stages go on. In Apan Dasha, we attain the stage of bhava. In Sampati Dasha, we attain prema. So this is all the internal meditation by which we attain. And here, when we discuss this point of the five states of the mind, the lake is the pure mind. And this pure mind can act also like an eye by which we can see what is below the lake, that is the self. So the mind is also like an eye. That's why many times we use this term, you know, many are familiar with this term, mind's eye, we say. So anything we see, we don't see with our eyes. We actually see with our mind's eye. What is our consciousness? If we are lusty, we will see with that eye only. If we are saintly, we will see a cow as an object of worship. But for a person who is a meat eater, he will see it as flesh. So like that, everything we see it through the mind's eye. So, okay, where were we? Yes. Yes, this is where we were discussing. Shabda Brahman. Now, any questions up till now? Anyone has about the Utsa technique, which we have been quite elaborately discussing? Any questions, any clarifications anyone has? Okay, one second, just a second. I would like to see, there are 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more slides are there. Okay, so there are a few more slides of discussion. So I would like to take that in the next class only. I will take up question answers now. Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, actually, first of all, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude for today's session, because I have been struggling while chanting Hari Naam for last 2 days. I could finish only 2 rounds, and I was quite disturbed with that. So today you have explained the exact problem, or you have pinpointed. I was trying to finish it off the name itself. I wasn't engrossed or involved in that chanting. So today I got to know the exact technique of chanting. We have to focus first on the 16 mantras. Then first you have to just focus on the 4 rounds of those 16 Maha Mantra, and that too with a lot of devotion and unconditional expectations from those. I have to just, secondly, being a science student, I like the concept of focusing on the sound vibration, because in my practice also we use ultrasound machine or a laser machine where light energy is converted into heat energy. So this particular concept has touched me a lot, and this will definitely help me to focus in my chanting very attentively. And I'm very grateful. So thank you. Thank you so, so, so very much. Thank you.
Yeah. One of the most important things during when we sit for chanting is that we are more in a receiver's mode than in an achiever's mode. That I have to finish my rounds, I have to chant my rounds. That is again a tendency to control. We have to become controlled by Krishna, controlled by Naam. So we have to open our heart to prayers, to grace, open our arms wide. Just like in churches, you know that they sit down, kneeling down, and sometimes they can raise their hands and pray to the Lord. So we can do these visual meditations before we sit to chanting to, you know, open our hearts, open up our minds, open up our hands. These all are like, these have very powerful impact, these postures. And just imagine, just like the heart of the Lord is like huge, like a Himalaya. The Himalayan mountains stretch from all the way to Kashmir to Nepal. So wide it is. So that's how vast is the Himalayas. So how vast is the heart of the Lord? Or if you go to an ocean and see how vast it is, the vastness of the ocean. And this is just a creation of Krishna. So how big is Krishna's heart that he has accommodated all these souls who want to enjoy in this world? And he's so accommodative as a million mothers. So please go into this prayerful mode of meditation to receive the holy name. And in this kind of a meditation, trying to chant from the heart, completely we can deal, you know, we need not deal with the mind. So this is how we also can apply this important, you can say, meditation, that we should be in a receiver's mode and not in a achiever's mode. Sunita Mataji has a question. Yes, Mataji. I have unmuted you. Yeah, I have unmuted you.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Pranam Prabhuji. Thank you for the nectarian lecture. And I had a question, maybe it's weird, I know it's weird to ask this question at this stage, but it's just a curiosity. How long does it take for self-realization?
Okay. Usually, Prabhupada spoke about it in his lectures, and we discussed once in the Kali Santara Upanishads, it is mentioned that one who, this is between the Brahma and Narada conversation about the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, one who chants this holy names 3.5 crores, he will become self-realized. I will be taking an entire session on that. So there it is mentioned that 3.5 crore names, it requires, with 16 rounds of chanting, 51 years. So if you can increase your rounds to even 4 more, that is 20 rounds, then 2 or 3 years reduces. And if you can increase to 24 or 30 or 32, then practically it's 27 years. Now, the most important thing here to be known is major part of our spiritual life as we begin. Initially, there is a lot of enthusiasm. We experience bliss in spiritual life, and that is the stage in our spiritual life. But many of our years, because we are not attentive, we chant many years Nama Prat chanting. So it all depends on the sense of urgency and how well you understand that I have to cross this Nama Prat stage. If you want to spend your time in many years in chanting Nama Prat, then you will continue. You will continue. But how long you want to continue? That means you will have to understand Sambandh Gyan. You have to understand what are these offenses, and work on the offenses. The more quickly you come to the Namapa stage, the more quickly you can progress and attain Shuddhanam, that is chanting the pure holy names. So it's not something fixed time. In one sense, there is some time mentioned, given in by our acharyas. But at the same time, it all depends on your this life practice and maybe from the previous life also. That all will add to it. And it all depends on how quickly you want to cross the Namapra stage and come to the Shuddhanams and come to the Namaba stage. If you come to the Namaba stage, very quickly the Anarthas will get destroyed, you will get taste, and from Namabas you can go to Shuddhanam stage. Okay. Any other questions or clarifications anyone has? Okay, so I'll just briefly recap what we discussed today. We began our discussion today with how Bhaktivinoda Thakur has mentioned how to become free from jada. And because this is because of alas, and because of the mind which is in the mode of passion, we want to quickly finish the chanting and we don't relish the nectar. The solution is Saintly Devotees Association, who are absorbed in the nectar of the holy name and see their conduct where they don't waste their time, and slowly, slowly their consciousness will reflect in our heart, and with the Utsar technique, we can become free from alas and chant more number of rounds, and then only we can destroy this jada. So if we don't focus on chanting more number of rounds, the jada will not go away. So that was the points Bhaktivinoda Thakur mentioned. And in our PowerPoint, we began with the discussion of how when we are with our beloved, we'd like to be with them, but with our chanting, we have different emotions. And we discussed the Utsar technique today, where we build blocks of attentive rounds, starting with one mantra and especially focusing on one Hare, and start chanting one attentive round, then build on to 4, and then 8, but to be alert. Alert means abhyas. I spoke about 12.8 and 12.9 in the Bhagavad Gita. What is abhyas? Abhyas means that moment you are conscious that the mind has wandered, you have to bring the mind back to the holy name. And this is a very strenuous exercise, and you might get exhausted. So don't worry, you are progressing. So 4 attentive rounds, you master, put another 4 blocks, make it 8 attentive rounds, and then you can become free from the dictations of the unruly mind. then the chanting becomes more internal, and internal visualization is possible through this meditation. This stage takes out the first among the four stages of the Utsa technique, takes around 3 years. It can take more also, it can take less also. And with this attentive chanting, anarthas get destroyed and we get taste, and our bhajan becomes internal. Initially, we chant very fast to finish our rounds because we are trying to control the mantra, but it is in the mode of passion. But in the advanced stages of ruchi, we are controlled by the Maha Mantra. Just like I gave that example of somebody who is bicycling down the hill. You know? So we are taken by a ride with the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So the chanting becomes deeper. And then the internal form, Rupa, manifests. In this context, we discussed the exercise which we did is to close our eyes and inhale and exhale 3 times and take the name of a person whom we have attraction, and immediately the form comes in the mind screen. But for Radha Krishna to come, which is a spiritual image, it is very difficult because the chit has unlimited impressions. That is why it is recommended that we only hear the mantra. So slowly, slowly the images will come, Rupa, and then Guna will come. And this example is there of the spiritual television, the spiritual technology Prabhupada refers to, and material technology, how it works. We gave this example. And vibration, how vibration reveals form, and how vibration has this effect. And that's why we have to concentrate on the Shabda Brahma and how to see our own Swarupa through the mind's eye, and that to the purified mind. And in this context, we discussed 6.20 and 2.55 from the Bhagavad Gita. So that is where we end our discussion today. There are a few more slides on this Utsa technique, which we will be taking up next week. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur ki jai, Sri Harinam Chintamani ki jai, Hare Krishna.